Yeah, very familiar music. Very familiar music. 1968 to 1975 on NBC. And before any further ado, let's bring aboard Kent McCord. Welcome, Kent.
How you doing, Mr. Trivia?
I'm doing pretty good. How about yourself?
It's fine, thank you.
Well, bring back a few memories when you hear that?
Yeah, it does. Fond memories.
I'm thinking 1968. Now, I'm like 19 years old when the show debuts. I'm in college. And I'm looking tonight. I'm doing a little research on the show and who you were up against. And, I got to say, the folks at NBC, they either didn't have the best brains in the world or what, but your show stayed a pretty good hit for years. Now, here's the rundown I've got. 68, 69, you're on Saturday nights opposite Jackie Gleason and The Dating Game. That's tough.
Yeah.
Then the next year, you're still Saturdays, and man, you're facing My Three Sons and The Lawrence Welk Show.
Yeah.
Then it stays like that for another year. Then you switch over to Wednesdays, and do you get any relief? No. You get The Carol Burnett Show and Bewitched. Man, did you have your work cut out for you. Then it gets a little easier the next year. Carol Burnett and The Paul Lynde Show. That didn't go anywhere. Then Wednesdays against Sonny and Cher Comedy Hour and Bob and Carol and Ted and Alice, which lasted about as long as it took to say the title. And then the last season, boy, you talking killer. Good Times and Happy Days.
Well,
wow.
There was a time schedule that they left out of there.
Yeah.
And that was Thursday nights at 9:30.
See, and now I'm wondering, Adam 12 is this nice family-oriented cop show, and for a long part of the run, you were kind of leading off NBC's lineup, but then I'm wondering why put you on that late. I'm thinking this is a show more adapted to like 8 o'clock, something like that.
Well, and, the family hour hadn't quite started yet.
Well, that's true.
If you remember, we were also on that first go-around, the first season, we were on at 7:30 here in Los Angeles and on the East Coast.
Mm-hmm.
It was 7:30, probably 6:30 in the Midwest. And that's when the network still had that half hour. And then it was during that season that the networks, the FCC took away the 7:30 to 8 o'clock time slot to try to develop more local made-in and played in programming.
Mm-hmm.
And so we moved up to 8 o'clock on Saturday night. And the interesting thing about it was, we were up against very tough competition, and the fact of the matter is that first year we hadn't done that well, and at the end of that season, NBC went to Jack Webb and said, look, we'll give you one of the shows, either Adam 12 or Dragnet, it's your choice, but we won't give you both of them. And Jack said, look, I'm tired of doing Dragnet, give it to the kids. And so they kept us on in that, and then we started to build when we went to that 9:30 time slot. And then, of course, when we went to Wednesday, that's where the show really became a big hit at 8 o'clock on Wednesday nights.
You know, I guess we should let at least part of our audience know that you're talking about the second incarnation of Dragnet. There had been the huge hit in the 50s, and then they brought it back around 67 or so with Harry Morgan as the sidekick, and it was doing well then.
Yes, it was. Yeah, it did very well.
Jack Webb was kind of a one-man company, I guess. If there was anybody in Hollywood that had a hyphenated series of titles behind his name, it was certainly Jack Webb.
Sure was. Jack directed every episode of Dragnet that was ever shot. And when you talk about being a hit, the first go-around of Dragnet, the black and white Dragnet that ran from 52 to 59, won the Emmy for the best drama 3 years in a row. It was the first best drama Emmy winner in history. And it was also the first series that had been made into a motion picture, a major motion picture, when Jack did the movie Dragnet in 1954, which also was a huge success. And then, of course, Jack went on and ran Warner Brothers for a year or two, Warner's Television, and then kind of went into semi-retirement and developed some things, and then went on over to Universal and came back with Dragnet. And in one season, Jack had 5 shows on the air. I think he had Dragnet, Us, Emergency, Mobile One and I think Heck Ramsey were the five shows, and possibly the DA in there.
Oh, with Robert Conrad.
With Bobby Conrad, yeah. Sure.
Which was actually spun off of an episode of Adam 12.
Adam 12, correct.
Yeah. You know, one thing I was going to mention when you brought about the subject of the feature film in 54, as I recall, Richard Boone was in that.
Yes.
And in the Dragnet series, and I would also say in Adam 12, you guys never lacked for some heavy hitter names for guest stars. I'm looking at a list of people associated with Adam 12 here, and I'm seeing Jackie Coogan and David Cassidy and Karen Black and Cloris Leachman and Trini Lopez and on and on and on. Naturally, you had a stable of people we referred to in the last hour. Well, when a caller was inquiring that there was a Jack Webb stock company, if you will.
Jack, very much like some of the great people in our industry, had those people who he depended upon to get performance from. They worked with him going all the way back to radio. The Virginia Greggs and the Stacey Harrises and the Herb Edelman, and you go on down the line, people that Jack worked with in radio, he continued to use up until the day Jack died, if he had anything that he was doing. And once you became a member of Jack's stock company, generally you were going to find work on a Jack Webb product, and as long as he was producing something and working. And like John Ford, the John Ford stock company of Ben Johnson and John Wayne and all those great Harry Carey and Harry Carey Jr., and you go on down through the history of that, and you'll see with Jack, he was very, very loyal to mm-hmm. those people around him and the workers. Jack was a very exacting kind of guy as far as his direction was concerned, and so it really saved him time to be able to rely on these people who knew what Jack expected from them, and so it really was a way for him to stay on schedule and make his life easier as a director, producer, editor, rewriter of the product coming through the whole nine yards.
Over the years, there were so many parodies and so many satires of Jack Webb, and some of them just so funny. But
yeah.
I wondered, how did Jack Webb appreciate those, or did he have a sense of humor, and could he say, "Oh, that's pretty good," or did he have a thin skin?
No, he had. I think the best parody of Jack Webb that was ever done was Jack Webb parodying himself.
Oh, I know what you're going to say on the
Tonight Show.
Oh.
Clyde Cooper and his Copper Clappers.
Yeah.
And that's a wonderful routine that whenever there was a best of...
The anniversary shows?
Yeah. They were right up there with the hatchet into Ed Ames.
Yeah, there you go.
So Jack very much had a sense of humor. It was a very dry sense of humor, but it was there, and it was intact.
You know, one of the nicest tributes, and it was only fitting, was shortly after his passing, the LAPD retired badge number 714 in his honor.
Yes, they did. And not only that, the service for Jack was held up at the Academy, and here in Los Angeles, the Los Angeles Police Academy. They're attended by the chief and the mayor and 1,000 other people. And Jack Webb, through his company Mark 7, had contributed a lot of money to the Los Angeles Police Department, and there are a couple of buildings up there at that police academy in Elysian Park in the shadow of Dodger Stadium that bear Jack's name.
And there were a lot of episodes of his work that were used as training films for rookies.
Yes, ours and of Dragnet's. There was a whole period of time there when Universal was bicycling prints all across the United States to various police organizations on various episodes that were used as training films.
We're talking with Kent McCord. Of course, he played Officer Jim Reed on Adam 12 for the entire run of the series. But prior to that, you had also worked on Dragnet. You had done other episodic TV, but I understand that you had some walk-on parts in some films that people might not be aware of.
Oh yeah, I had started in the business. Ricky Nelson became and I became friends, and I started doing Ozzie and Harriet, and I started working extra on the show and standing in for Rick, and then Ozzie threw me my first line in any type of motion picture or television was a line called "Who's," you know, I said, "Who's Rick?" was the line, and it was based on an episode of Ozzie and Harriet where a fraternity party, Ozzie and Harriet had left town and they left their house to Rick, and he was having a fraternity party there, and Ozzie and Harriet come home early, and there's this party going on, and they walk in the front door, and I'm standing there, and they say, "Can you tell me where Rick is?" And I say, "Who's Rick?" And that was the first line I ever did. But the way we shot Ozzie and Harriet was generally September through the late part of May, and then would take summers off, and that left me available to work around town and pick up extra work and do stunt work. At the time, I was going to college and playing football, and so I could pick up some extra work and stuff, and I wound up doing some pretty good films, like 7 days in May, and also that's based on that first meeting with Rick was based on a football game that we played against Elvis Presley and his team and the guys from Memphis that would travel with Elvis when he would come out here to the West Coast to make movies over at MGM.
Now, what would happen if anybody gang-tackled Elvis? Did the Memphis Mafia come over and shoot him or anything?
No, we were all perfect gentlemen when we played that. We played real hard, and it was all clean hitting and everything, and nobody tried to take any cheap shots because, you know, everybody knew the rules, in essence, and that never really happened that I know of. But anyway, that, you know, I wound up in a lot of films. You know, I know where I am in them, and my wife and my mother. That's about it.
Well, that's good. When we return, we're going to take a little break here first, Kent, and when we return, I would like to talk a little bit about your background and some other things that you've been involved with, namely auto racing and the like, and then
sure.
Perhaps a few anecdotes about Adam 12 somewhere down the road. This is KTRS Radio in St. Louis, 550 on your dial. Our guest this hour is Kent McCord.
Kids like your...
Oh, yeah. Search the recesses of the brain, folks. That's a theme from The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet. And that's one of the spots where Kent McCord got his start in the biz.
Yep.
Yeah. I'm looking at a photo that Tim Neely brought me of you and Rick Nelson holding a moose head.
Yeah.
And I have to assume that this was a prop for an episode or something, but why a publicity department would come up with this, I don't know.
In the shot, you mean?
Yeah.
The episode was called The Blue Moose.
The Blue Moose.
And it was supposed to have been a ritual with our fraternity, and one of the other fraternities comes in and steals it. And then the whole episode revolved around us getting the moose back. So I don't know if that wound up in TV Guide or not, that particular shot. But that was probably the reason for the purpose of the shot.
Now, do you still keep in contact with David Nelson?
Yes, I do. I just talked to him the other day.
Yeah, and how's he doing?
David is doing fine. David has a company called Casablanca that he produces and directs commercials worldwide, and has been quite successful with that. But we had a conversation. We've had a couple meetings on the potential of a film about Rick, and... And I just called Dave the other day just to check in and see how everything was going. So.
That's one of the more tragic incidents involving the death of a celebrity, and I know that he was a close friend of yours.
Yeah.
I'm sure that not only the loss of a friend would hurt, but there were horrible rumors at the time, et cetera, and I guess it was now, what, at 1985, was it? That
New Year's Eve, 1985.
Yeah. Man, I'll tell you.
Yeah. It was an accident that really needn't have happened. It was just a malfunction in a heater, and those DC-3s had gasoline-fed heaters, and the gas line came out of the wing tank down the center of the fuselage into the heater that was situated in the baggage compartment, and something malfunctioned, and the thing caught fire. And unfortunately, when they put out a mayday, they were given a wrong location to the location of an airport. But essentially what occurred on the flight was that when the interior of the plane started burning, the compounds that were present, the insulation, the aluminum, and all of the other stuff, the seating and all of that proved lethal. And it was like dropping a cyanide pill. So it was quick whatever happened in there. And nobody, I mean, there were two survivors. I don't know if anybody who was familiar with what occurred. There were two survivors, the pilot and the co-pilot. And essentially they survived because the...
They were sealed off from the cabin?
Well, they were sealed off in the cabin, but also they... for them, it was lucky the windscreen on the windshield on the plane from the inside had sooted up, and they couldn't see out of it, so they had to open the side wings, or, they're like wind wings on a car almost. They had to open those to get line of sight, and that gave them fresh air to breathe. And they were able to bring the plane down and actually land it. The plane did not crash, as everybody likes to. It landed and rolled into a grove of trees and knocked the wings off. But by that time, according to the NTSB report, everybody on board was dead.
Right.
And was deceased. So.
And the chances for a project like this really going somewhere, looking good?
Well, I would imagine so. I think something should be done on Rick. A lot of people really don't understand, what Rick meant to a lot of us growing up. The show in itself, The Adventures of Ozzie and Harriet, was the longest-running family show in television history. It started in 1944 on radio and ended in 1966, 22 years later,
mm-hmm.
on television. And, of course, a whole generation of people, or several generations of people, grew up listening to it and watching it. And literally watched David and Rick grow up in front of their very eyes, and those two young men became like family members to everybody. And so when Rick started playing music, he basically brought rock and roll into the living room. And in an era when a lot of what was going on was not palatable to parents, Ricky made it that. And helped advance rock and roll. And of course, he's a member of the Hall of Fame and the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
And a lot of his songs were introduced right on the show.
You bet they were. Yeah. He had one of the great rock and roll bands backing him, and the Jordanaires, as far as vocals were concerned, background vocals, and people like Glenn Campbell and played with the group. And traveled with Rick at times, playing bass. Rick had a bass player who hated to fly, and there were just some trips that Joe couldn't make, and so Glenn would cover for Joe Osborne. Rick's background in music, a lot of people also don't know that Ozzie and Harriet. Ozzie had a band out of college.
Oh yeah,
and played. All over the East Coast, and then Harriet became the vocalist, and they came out here to Hollywood to do band stuff, and Harriet became one of the Golden Girls along with Ginger Rogers and Lucille Ball. And anyway, Rick grew up with a musical history, and I'm always amused at people who think that Rick just kind of jumped into it because of the popularity of the television show.
You know, you almost sound like you could be a Mr. Trivia yourself.
Well, that's a subject that I know a lot about, having lived through it. So,
you know, one other area that I wanted to explore too is a side of your life that perhaps many listeners are unaware of, and that's your fascination with auto racing.
Yeah, I think it's the fascination that most youth growing up in America have had, and I had always been interested in automobile racing as far as being a fan and everything was concerned, and then I got the opportunity to go back to Indianapolis in 1970, and then got fascinated with growing up in America, every Memorial weekend, the highlight of Memorial weekend was out doing yard work with the race on. And of course, in the early days and everything, that race would last sometimes 5 hours, so you could get a lot of yard work done with the diversion of listening to that race. And from the time I was a little kid, I remember that. And then I got that opportunity to go back there, and a friend of a man who became a very good friend of mine, a man named Bruce Walkup, who was well-known throughout the Midwest, had a car dealership in Sullivan, Indiana, just south of Terre Haute, and is now the president of a bank in Sullivan, grew up out here in Southern California, and was a very close friend of two guys that, this may be a long, convoluted story, but I was bouncing in a bar when I was first under contract at Universal out in a little town called Pico Rivera, and I was actually making more money bouncing in that bar than I was under contract at Universal.
I can believe that. I've heard some of those horror stories.
Yes. So anyway, Bruce was a good friend of two of the fellas who were also bouncing at that establishment with me, and we became friends back at the Speedway. And then in 1972, I tried my hand at becoming a car owner, and we almost pulled it off. And then after that, I just became a fan until I had an opportunity to start driving in 1977 in the Toyota Pro Celebrity races that they used to hold at the Grand Prix in Watkins Glen, New York, and here in Long Beach. And from that, I just put the word out that I was looking for a good competitive series that I could race in. And I wound up doing a VW Rabbit Bilstein Cup for several years, and then running for Nissan in an endurance series that started out as the Playboy Endurance Cup. That was an Southern Sports Car Club of America's endurance series, and then running IMSA series. And then I've raced not as much as I want to be, but I've just raced infrequently the last few years. But I just had a meeting the other day to try to put a program together, and because it is a lot of fun.
Now, having done a very successful TV cop series, there were occasions when there were car chases. Now, I'm assuming in long shots they probably had stunt doubles, stunt drivers and that, but were there occasions where you were behind the wheel and you got to really put it down to the floor?
If you remember, it became such a big deal that we made a whole special show out of it. I never drove.
Yeah, it was always Malloy.
It was always Marty.
Yeah.
And then finally we did an episode where I drive and he's like a backseat driver. He's like, you know, the worst backseat driver you could have. You know, watch out here and watch out there. But it became by design almost that we had Marty driving and me just riding along as the passenger. I think part because in a lot of instances the senior guy wants to be in control. And the other part was that when Marty was doing a series called Route 66 that had been very, very successful, Marty did most of the driving in that. But Marty did most of the stunt driving up until a time when we had a thing where we had to go over some railroad tracks, and they hadn't... the car bottomed out and tore the bottom of the car up pretty good. And some producer said something negative about it, and Marty said, "Well, hell, go out and hire a stuntman then if you want. You know, if you're gonna bitch at me for doing, you know, what I've been doing, get a stunt guy to drive." But
right.
Up until that time, Marty did most of the stuff and was quite capable of handling.
Now, were there occasions where people are coming through Universal on the studio tour, and perhaps you guys are either in uniform or you're ready to shoot a scene, and you had to wave hi to all the fans?
Well, Yeah, that occurred, but I think one of the things that kind of kept us. One day we're walking through the lot, and this was after the show had been on for a long time, and we were fairly well recognizable to everybody, and people would come up and want to get an autograph or something, or we'd go to the commissary, and fans would wait for you when you came out of the commissary at Universal, and you'd sign a few autographs. And one day we were kind of in a hurry, and a guy yelled at us, and we thought, geez, he's going to ask us for an autograph, and we got to get back to work, to the stage or something. And we went, yeah, and the guy says, listen, when you guys get done, can you check the plugs on stage 25? We think he thought we were a couple firemen on the lot, and that kind of kept us,
we looked
at each other and said, so much for popularity.
This is great, because my next question was going to be, were you ever mistaken for real police officers and somebody wanted you to take care of some business?
You bet. That used to happen, and especially with Adam 12. When we began doing the show, the first season, and you have to remember in 68, a lot of television was bottled and everything, and you had a lot of Westerns on that were done on the back lot, and you could get away with those kind of exteriors. When we were exterior the first year, it was mainly on the back lot. But then the back lot very quickly began to look like the back lot. And when we got the pickup for the second season, we started going out on the street. And so the car that we drove was just a car that was ordered along with the rest of the LAPD fleet. And then it was outfitted with everything that was LAPD. It was the official seal on the side of the thing and the protect and serve sign and the siren and the red lights and the whole thing. So there was no markings on the car to distinguish it from a real police car. And I remember being downtown one time when some guy pulled up in a car and said, "Hey, there's something going on behind you. You guys ought to go check it out." And we said, "Look, go around the corner. There's a real policeman standing there with the film crew, and tell him." You know, and this guy kind of looked at us and followed and just went ahead and did it. But that happened a lot. And I remember also one time we were shooting a shot where we had the camera inside the car in the back seat. And it was over the shoulder between Marty and me, and we were supposed to be searching for a guy in the street. And we were downtown Los Angeles in the Skid Row District. And we were, so the camera wasn't visible to anybody. And we pull around the corner hustling pretty good with Marty had pretty good pace with the car so that when he hit the brakes, it screeched to a halt. I jump out of the car when I see this guy and start running down the road with my gun drawn because the guy was supposed to have been armed. And a lot of people down there, derelicts.
Not,
there is no gentle way.
Yes, not stalwarts of society.
Right, but they started hitting the streets and in the doorways and everything, and I went, "Whoa, man, I mean, if we better do this a different way because..."
Somebody might have produced a real one.
A real one down there.
Yeah.
So those kind of things happen once in a while.
We need to take another break. We're talking with Kent McCord from Adam 12 fame and many, many other things, including the auto racing that we've talked about and some other things. We want to talk a little bit more about his friendship and long relationship with Martin Milner. We'll do all of that right after this.
Ladies and gentlemen, the story you're about to see is true. The names have been changed to protect the innocent.
Yep, that's the theme from Dragnet. And we've already mentioned that this evening, haven't we, Kent?
Yeah.
Some of Kent's more recent work has included appearances on Lawless and Silk Stockings and, Dark Skies and Renegade. And I understand you do some voiceover work, too.
I've been doing some voiceover work. I had a Saturn, National Saturn that was running, and a Harley-Davidson and Canon copiers and various other things. I just keep doing that. I've got another one coming up tomorrow.
Now, I know a little bit about the business. I'm going to assume that there were occasions, whether you were on the back lot or whether you were out on the street, where because of, an airliner going by or somebody, dropped something, that you had to go in and loop some dialogue. Was that something that the people at Universal or perhaps Jack Webb would pull out their hairs because you had to go in and do extra work like that?
Oh, well, that just comes, that's part of the way that the business works.
Everybody understands that.
Yeah.
Okay. One thing that we have not gotten into so far is the fact, and I'm very happy to say this because it's quite the contrary most of the time, is that you're still married to your high school sweetheart.
Yes, I am.
Yeah. And three children, as I understand.
Yes, yeah. The baby is now coming up 22, and my middle daughter is going to be 26, and our oldest is 34.
Yeah.
And works for a man named Brandon Tartikoff.
Oh, a familiar little name.
Yeah.
Yeah, NBC, Paramount. You name it, he's done it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All three kids are very creative. Megan, who is our middle daughter, is... did a pilot with me when she was 5.5 years old, a pilot that I did called Pine Canyon's Burning, where I played a widowed fireman with two young children, and she played my daughter in that.
That had to be neat.
It was.
Yeah.
It was one of the shows I thought should have been on the air, and it didn't quite make it. It was basically Little House on the Prairie meets Emergency. and it was a heck of a concept. And
interesting
I really,
premise, yeah.
Well, yeah, yeah. And it had sold, and the politics in this town being what they are, it wound up getting put on the back burner, and then there was a change of administrations at NBC, and when that occurs, that's usually the kiss of death for anything that's,
right.
That's in development with the previous regime. So it wound up being left behind.
Would you mind if we take a call from one of our listeners?
Not at all.
Okay. This is Benjamin calling. Benjamin, say hi to Kent McCord.
Hi, Kent. How you doing?
I'm just fine, Benjamin.
Oh, I love this show, Ed on 12.
Thank you.
Yeah. Question I had to ask you, what was the name of the lady that played the dispatcher for your show?
Her name was Sharon Claridge.
Sharon Claire.
Yes. Yeah. And she was actually a dispatcher from the Los Angeles Police Department.
She was with it?
Yeah, she knew her business.
Yes, she
just
retired.
As a matter of fact, I just signed a big card to her not too long ago. She just retired.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, they had something on the news wires about that at the time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was always curious who played as a dispatcher and everything.
Yeah.
Okay, Benjamin, thanks a lot for calling in.
Thanks a lot.
All right, bye. We mentioned earlier before the break, Martin Milner. Now, this is a gentleman that you've known now, I guess, almost 30 years.
Yep.
And I'm assuming still a close friend.
Yes, he is. Yeah. In fact, I just talked to Marty the other day, too. Marty and I stay in very close contact. We've been going out and doing some of these movie, television, autograph, and memorabilia shows that come up occasionally around the United States. And those are kind of fun to do, and it keeps us in contact with each other as well as the public. And and Marty right now does a radio show that is produced live on Saturday and Sunday morning. It's called Hookup, and it's about fishing. And that's syndicated in, I think, about 20 or 25 markets right now. And it deals with Marty started as a hobby fly fishing, and went and did an appearance on this show. And after he finished, the producer said, you're pretty familiar with this stuff. I'd love to have you, if you're interested, to come on and be a co-host on this thing. And it opened up a whole new world for Marty. He's been all over the world. He's been to Russia fishing in streams where no Westerner had been for 70 years. He's been to Central America and South America. He goes to Alaska about 3 times a year now.
Hey, it's never bad to get paid for your hobby.
It sure isn't, and that's exactly what Marty has found. He turned his hobby into a paying endeavor here.
Yeah,
so
that's great.
Yeah.
You know, his career goes back to at least Life with Father.
That is the beginning.
And
he had done small theater in Seattle.
That's like 1947, as I recall.
Yes.
And then I can remember a very young Martin Milner, I believe, was it in Sands of Iwo Jima?
Yep.
Yeah.
He's
the baby face guy who comes in. He's got a paperback book, as I recall.
Yep.
And he's one of the replacements. Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
Oh, he's good, folks. I told you.
But also now, Marty's relationship with Jack goes back to a movie called The Halls of Montezuma.
Oh, yeah.
When he first met Jack. And then out of that, he began doing the radio show, the Dragnet radio show. Marty worked with Jack on radio. As a matter of fact, played his young partner. A man named Barton Yarborough had started out with Jack, Barton died suddenly.
I think in the first season.
Yes, and Jack hadn't been prepared for that, of course, and so he went through several different partners until they finally came up with Ben Alexander, who was the partner on radio, and then through the first series.
And the epitome of the police partner as Frank Smith.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely.
He was fantastic. You know, another person that I meant to touch on earlier and I neglected to do so was Gary Crosby, who had a continuing role on Adam 12. Now, here was a fella who he had a lot of hard knocks in life, and yet he acquitted himself very well on that program.
He sure did, and he was a delight to be around, and Gary is sorely missed. He passed away about a year ago, and it was one of the sad tragedies and everything. I didn't know that Gary was ill. I went to the funeral, and Gary and I used to touch base, and then Gary had moved to Las Vegas, and I hadn't heard from him, and I didn't even know he was back in town. And the next thing I knew is that he had passed away, and it was one of those unexpected passings.
That leads me to still another person who was, I would think, in, if not in every episode, certainly the overwhelming majority, the gentleman who played kind of your supervisor, William Boyette was the actor's name.
Bill Boyette, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And he's still working, I assume?
He sure is, yeah. And you'll see Bill on commercials and doing voiceovers and in different films and television shows and everything. And Bill still looks the same and is a delightful guy. So
now, in doing a little research earlier this weekend, I'm looking through a book, and it's got a pretty good episode guide of Adam 12, and I'm pulling out names like we've mentioned tonight, Virginia Gregg and others, and I'm seeing in here Christina Sinatra. Is that the Christina Sinatra I think it is?
Tina Sinatra, yes. And Frank Jr.
And
also
Frank,
worked.
Yeah, Frank Jr. worked on the
also
show.
Also worked on the
yeah.
show.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, you know, we had a couple crooners going on there.
That's not bad.
And Frank Jr. is out with a big band, and I'll tell you, he's got a CD out that just came out doing his father's stuff
mm-hmm.
that is almost indistinguishable from his dad. He's really a chip off the old block and a heck of an entertainer. And he's got a big band that he tours with, and, you know, and so people should be on the lookout for him because it's a delightful show.
Now, I heard something just recently, it was either in the trade papers or off the wire services that we get here, about possible a sequel to a film that you did years ago, and yours was a sequel, and that was Predator 2. I understand there's another Predator possibly in the makings.
I haven't heard that, but when we finished Predator 2, I lived.
So you're available.
And there's another one coming up that I did a sequel of a sequel of. And that is a thing called Return of the Living Dead 3. And I just talked to the producer yesterday, and he said they're in discussions about doing Return of the Living Dead 4, and they are talking about using me to bridge the two shows, because I lived in that one also.
And you wouldn't mind doing that?
No. It was a fun show to do, and, you know, those things kind of live on forever. They become cult things, and... I don't think actors can have too many of those.
Yeah. Now, I understand there was another project that was near and dear to your heart that apparently was the Nashville Network was going to pick up, and then, like
yes.
you said earlier, some politics played a part, and that was a project that you had created, correct?
Yes. Yeah, it was actually what I had been doing. And I'm still researching a project for me to bring back the Reed Malloy characters, and I've been talking to people at Universal about it. But not as the two, yeah, the two characters, but not in a black and white. Me as a lieutenant, Marty is a deputy chief in the hierarchy of the department. That's what I've been talking about. And I had been in development on something that I wanted to do similar to that called Hollywood Division, and couldn't get Universal to tumble with the concept, and wound up going to Nashville and shooting a pilot. It was a 2-hour movie of the week called Nashville Beat. And I, Marty played a captain of detectives down there, and I played his old partner, who is a lieutenant in charge of the gang squad here in Los Angeles with a lot of expertise dealing with street gangs. And they began to have a problem in Nashville, which was actually occurring at the time that we shot this, and with Los Angeles street gang guys going down there and setting up drug distribution and stuff. And that was occurring all over the United States, if you remember,
mm-hmm.
back in about 89. A lot of stories being written about it, about Crips and Bloods migrating across the country and doing that very thing. So that was the premise that we set up. And Marty calls his old buddy Kent, and I go into Nashville. We set up a task force, take the bad guy out. And what I had done is created my character was a widower with a couple teenage kids. And I see that Nashville is very much like the town that I grew up with. In here in Los Angeles, and but years before, and get the idea that, you know, Marty and I might make a pretty good team back in, you know, working together again, and that was going to be the setup for the series.
Mm-hmm.
And we were penciled in for 104 half hours on the Nashville Network.
Oh, that would have been sweet.
That would have been very nice, and
yeah.
to shoot on location in Nashville and to utilize the city itself, and it's a wonderful location, and
right.
also the music and the whole history of the
sure.
of the city, and
yeah.
being the music capital of the world, and then doing a real good cops and robbers television show based
exactly.
out of there.
Yeah.
And but essentially what happened was the hierarchy of the network said, let's stay with what got us here, and that was the fishing, racing, and country music.
Yeah.
And now it's just been, I just took that project over to CBS because CBS just bought the Nashville Network.
Well, let's hope something happens.
Well, you know, you never know. I just got a call back from the head of development over there saying they're concentrating on this season, and then he said, let him, you know, I get a hold of him in 6 months, and we'll see if anything can be done then.
Kent, listen, we're up against the news. This has been a fast hour. I've really appreciated it, and an excellent interview. A very, very multicolored career that you've been successful, and continued success to you in your career.
Thank you very much.
And look forward to seeing you on screen real soon, whether it be Night of the Living Dead or Predator or whatever, okay?
You bet.
If you'll stay on...
To my friends there and Tim Neely and everybody else, it was nice talking with you.
Okay, great. If you'll stay on hold, my producer, Cray, would like to say a word to you.
Thank you.
Once again, we wish you all the best.
Thank you very much.
All right, bye-bye.